Hi, I'm Reinier Zonneveld and I'm going to make a beat from scratch for you for DJ Mac. Let's go. Here I have a template set up that connects all my hardware that I have here. I send MIDI out from Ableton and then record the audio back in via the audio input that I have. Normally I have them directly in my Ableton, but now I use this mixer in between because I want to use a bit more equipment at the same time. One very important thing is that I don't use the external instrument plugin from Ableton itself, because there's some problems with the delay compensation. And if you do it the way I've set it up here, you can manually adjust the track delay, put a negative track delay, and it sends out and basically delays all the audio, and you can just look to get everything lined up. So usually when I start with an ID, like maybe a bass line or a melody. Could also be drums, but I try to avoid to have to start with drums, because you maybe lock yourself already way too much in with your IDs. So I prefer to start with melodies, bass line and stuff. So let's fire up the 303. It's an original one, but it's modified to a bit MIDI, so I can send MIDI notes from the computer to it rather than having to program on this little computer here, because I hate it. It's horrible. It takes so much time. If you want to program a sequence in this, you're probably 10 minutes further before you have something. Nice thing to do with the 303 is to have some accents in there to make it more interesting. Maybe here and there. Portamental slides are also very nice with 303. You can just program them in like this. Okay, so we have that down. Over here we have the Moog. It's a great monophonic synthesizer that I've also in my life set a lot. Over here we have the Vermona DRM1 MK3. This is the first drum computer I bought for my student loan back then. And it was, there's a lot of options, a very analog sound. And it's a really cool sound design tool. You can make really special sounds with that. Then over here, the 101. It's like my favorite classic synthesizer. Sounds really good. And basically, there's not too much settings, but it's still very versatile. But it's very hard to make a bad sound with this. It always sounds amazing, in my opinion. That's also why I use this one also always in my live setup. And this one is a bit too precise, like a bit too complicated. Like one move of the knob and the pitch goes up a whole octave. So I double up the 303 line with the 101, but because I use the LFO controlling the pulse width of the pulse, the phase of the 101 will randomly shift, and then you don't have a constant phase cancellation on your bass line. So this is good if you're layering in a sub bass or a bass. Maybe look for a chord progression, sort of that can be Interesting. Maybe I change some notes in the sequence, that the top notes play sort of a melody. It's a bit more neutral, a bit less melody-like. So we have space to introduce later. Let's make simple chord progression. Maybe something like a pad to go with. I really like like analog pads can be nice, but I like to use soft synths for that. Augmented strings, that's the one. Can make some pads behind this. That follow the chord progression. Valhalla reverbs. Valhalla shimmer is really nice for pads. The only thing that you have to watch out for is that it really gets messy very quick in your stereo field. So there's this setting called Big Stereo, which to me sounds always the nicest, but it also fucks up your mix the most, so be aware of that. Great. Okay, so we have that, and then we can make a string like progress a bit over time, because like this, like a big mistake with arranging strings and pads is to keep it like boring. It's nice to have some movement in them. Also for the chord progression, maybe I change a little bit towards the end of it. Okay, some movement in the strings. So just add some extra notes on top here, and there. Like you're still keeping the same chord progression, but by adding these notes, you get a sort of really epic build up. I like epic sound, so perfect. Just every time you add a couple more, it gives you nice movement. That's cool. So if they're down, maybe we duplicate it and play some other string lead on top that loops. Thank you. Okay, nice. Now it's time for a beat. I have now a 3-3 line and a 101, something on the Moog, some things that I like to start working with. And then usually I would then go and create a beat. For this it can take super much time sometimes, like I can be 24 hours in the kick drum if I want to get it right. But for now it's record, like what we have here. I have the 909 sequence just in my live set. I normally sequence also these machines from a machine, but in the studio not, I like to program it in. So I sequence the 909 from the machine because I like the sequencer way more. And if you sequence it with MIDI, it's tighter than when you use the sequencer of the 909 itself. So I just press start and then should be able to get a beat out of this. So first I make a kick bass. I like to have everything sample accurate. And when you send out MIDI to the 909, you get audio back. It will, you have MIDI jitter. So basically every kick is a couple of milliseconds too early or too late. And if you start layering things like this, this doesn't work because every time the kick hits, it will hit different phase-wise with the rest of the components. And yeah, you cannot get it tight. Or well, you can, like in a lot of house music or groovy stuff, this actually is very cool. But in the music I make, like I like when something hit, every kick needs to hit the same, be very powerful, like yeah, music suited for big stages with big sound systems, so I like to be tight. So I'm going to record a separate kick from the 909 here. Then I get a sampler here. Ready to go. Also here I make sure that the end of the sample is not till here, because somehow when you do that, it cuts off the sample, and try to avoid clicking, but for that it basically draws a little envelope there. And so if you do this and you play the kick, the every kick except the first one will sound a bit different. So when you drop the beat at some point, the first kick will hit different than the other kicks, which is something I would not like. So I draw it in that they don't touch. Good, this is the kick. Then I will find something bassy under it. This is a very nice drum computer, was one of my first one. It's good for Mona DRM1. There's a lot of settings. Only problem is like the pitch control. This is for the kick. Like, yeah, it's ridiculous. Why would you want such a high kick? So it's very hard to set it right. But best is to tune it just by ear and see what the pitch is. Sometimes this is hard. What I can then do is like I pitch up the sample, for example, 2 octaves here with the 909. And you see here that this is a little bit out of tune. It's like 3 hertz too low, but it's on A. So and my track, this was written, was in B minor, so I could say I put the kick on B, but because my bass line is also, as at the beginning of the sequence, has a B in it, the chance that the kick and the bass were good together, it's quite hard to get it right. So I actually just maybe keep the kick on A, and they have the bass notes on B and G, and they're never similar, so it's easier for mixing, in my experience. So here we have a 909. And then I've tried to find a good layer for this. We have already have a click from the 909, so we don't need a click from this here. It sounds pretty cool. And the pitch of this is F sharp, so we're basically playing like a little chord with the kick and the bass now. And then maybe add some low percussion. Going to put that on separate audio tracks. So we have here, I'm manually going to put everything exactly on the grid here. Then I use here transient mode you can use, but I use the beat one and 1/16, so basically it will warp every sample from the 1/16 note. I put this group to some outboard equipment here, named the Manly here. It's a mastering compressor. It's a really distinctive sound. It's very nice to boost bass or highs with it. Very creamy sound, so to say. Then we have here a mastering EQ that's very transparent. So this is best to use on the master bus. The Manly you can also use on the master bus. The only thing is that if you use it too much, you will really smear the transients out and it will sound a bit weak. Then this is the Whitestone tube loading amp. So basically there's like real tubes in that, and it literally warms up the sound. That's really nice. And it's a very subtle effect that you might not notice that it's on the first time, but when you then use it for some time and you compare the version with and without, it really adds a sort of golden sheen to the sound. And then I have the Mezelec compressor expander. Basically compression is when an element goes, like the sound goes over a certain threshold, then it automatically pulls the volume back. But this one can also expand, so that's the other way around. When the sound comes under a certain threshold, you pull up the sound. I use it mainly for expanding. It's really nice to fatten up the sound. Just use it a little bit. And then here we have the solid state logic mastering compressor. And it's basically very transparent, very nice compressor with a lot of options that we didn't use now. You can individually, for example, compress the sides and the mono signal. Got distortion out of the SSL and I mixed it slowly in with the original single, and then I recorded many versions with different settings of the equipment so that I can later decide which ones to use. Okay, now quickly arrange what we have here and later make a beat on top. Let's try out some new sequences. Reverb. I like the one from FabFilter. Really good plugins. Very clean. Look for something like a room or something. Nice. Okay, now let's record a beat. I do it always in one go with the 909. Let's start a track. So I would make here maybe a break in the track, so the kick goes out. Oh. Then I have here the machine, which is the core of my live setup as well. And the machine I use to sequence my synthesizer and my drums. Here in the studio I sequence with mostly with Ableton, but live I usually also sequence my hardware with it. Final step, export everything. At the end, when I'm finished, I just record everything I have, but then put to some mastering equipment. So I always master, mix and master my tracks myself. And usually, when I just finish it, I do this. So I have here a chain of gear set up for just this.
No.